All of them so near, yet so far by intercity.
Rowing were all trying to go faster. What they did was tweaked the infrastructure, moved track across, eased the curves, you eased junctions, and you went faster. But eventually you got to the point where you was going as fast as you could, and then you moved up another step.
An ambitious new project was launched, the Advanced Passenger Train, a tilting train which could travel on old-fashioned curving rail tracks at 150 miles an hour.
His team of outsiders had to create the single most advanced rail vehicle in the world, where every component was an innovation.
Faster than any British train had ever been before.
In 1971, a mobile test rig emerged. It embodied many of the important elements of APT design: the wheel sets, the suspension, and the tilt system. Aircraft design and manufacturing techniques were used to make them light in weight, but with a high degree of stiffness and strength.
Iconic pieces of British engineering. We'd never seen anything like it.
At last, I think railways are having some luck. Mm. Things are going our way, people are coming our way.
British Rail was saying that this was the cornerstone of their policy. They envisaged that about 60 of these trains would be whizzing up and down the West Coast Main Line, and they really had tremendous hopes placed in it.
In 1972, BR started track testing.
Beginning a series of slow-speed runs at Derby, the team of research engineers who designed the train are there to check on the behaviour of their latest creation.
It was a world-shaking development in railways. Everybody in the world knew that at Derby we had set up a research station, so they knew they were onto something big.
We were ahead of the world at the time then.
I'm sure the customer will keep confidence in us, and we will prove the winning way to go.
If you don't think that, you can go away thinking it now. So how about that then?
The train's power came from 10 untried gas turbines. They'd been supplied by a new engineering company, British Leyland. The train was moved back to Derby by a non-union manager. Asleff was outraged and called a national strike. Suddenly, the tilting train was responsible for bringing Britain to a halt, and it cost British Rail over £1 million. The public perception of the project was now badly tainted, and work on the tilting train was suspended.
After the battle with the drivers' union, the APT might simply have brushed it away like this, were it not for the exceptional resolve and determination of our British engineers.
As a result of test track and mainline running, it has been modified and developed.
Over the next few years, Alan and his team fine-tuned the tilting train.
It was the stuff of science fiction.
They'd had a frustrating wait because of technical problems, but now they were ready to go.
By 1976, the research phase was complete.
In 1981, there was a risk that the funding could be withdrawn. A decision was taken to put the train into service.
Three trains were rushed into service. The big launch was on the 7th of December, 1981.
The central station in Glasgow this morning before 7.
At long last, the space-age APT tilting train was going into service, after 13 years' work and a cost of £37 million.
Do you think you're going to make it to London today?
Oh, of course we are.
The tilt is quite nice. The tilt, no discomfort at all. In fact, if anything, it improves the ride.
I've been very impressed. I think it's been a very good ride. I think it's very comfortable. And altogether, I think this is one of Britain's great technological achievements.
It was too revolutionary for its own good.
As a train, was it just too different?
It then became apparent that the train was doing its tilting thing exactly as it was designed to do, and the horizon was going up and down, and the first instances of the dreaded tilt sickness occurred.
The winter temperatures had caused the mechanisms to freeze up, and the train's smooth tilt turned into a noticeable jerk.
The tilting train's third run from Glasgow, a trip packed with journalists and cameramen.
After only 8 minutes, the lights flickered and dimmed, and APT coasted to a shameful halt.
If it weren't so serious, it would be
funny. I mean, they took a whole party of journalists and train spotters up to Glasgow and put us on this new train. And of course, they got absolutely terrible press.
The train got through the borders, the scene of her last breakdown, but there was more trouble at Preston.
But the adverse weather conditions and technical failures were the least of the engineers' worries. Some of the train's passengers were feeling distinctly unwell.
Back in the 60s, it was talk of super trains. Railway technology, we were told, would revolutionise our lives.
It was plagued with technical problems, and passengers complained that the tilting spilled their drinks, caused an uncomfortable ride, even made them feel travel sick.
And whenever there was a problem with it, I mean, everybody just, media-wise, leapt on the bandwagon.
All the press had been boozed up the night before, and that's what made them sick. Well, I hadn't. And I felt fine until it got daylight, and then started to feel queasy, and a lot of us did.
The train's technical problems were primarily those of overall reliability.
I rode on the first journey on the APT. I had a very sober night before, and I definitely felt queasy.
APT decided enough was enough.
It's now 11:15, the time we were due to arrive at Euston. But here we are at Crewe, 158 miles from London. And we've been told that because of adverse weather conditions down the line, the advanced passenger train will be terminating its journey right here.
It was a fatal blow. The train was taken out of service.
The prototype is to find out the things that are wrong just as much as to find out the things that are right.
In fact, it's failed. Like other brave new British inventions, we couldn't quite get right. The British Rail have, for the time being, abandoned plans for 160 mile an hour rail travel.
If problems persist, it certainly won't see the light of day.
The biggest question mark of all hangs over the APT.
British Rail's advanced passenger train is back on the rails, 2.5 years after its first disastrous launch.
Engineers were concerned that the train still wasn't ready. BR managers were under pressure to show something for their investment. These were the days when the company's image was at rock bottom.
It would be a perfectly sensible decision that the next mainstream investment does not involve the advanced passenger train.
We felt that we had reached a point where the reliability levels were sufficient to operate it in regular passenger traffic.
A highly embarrassed British Rail had been trying to sort out why the tilting mechanism made people feel sick and the train proved so unreliable. Not all the problems have been ironed out.
This one doesn't work. Yes, but this one's broken down.
Later generations of APT will travel at 140 miles an hour, and only the coaches will tilt, not the locomotives. The cushioned world of government-backed research and development was about to change. The Conservatives had been swept to power, and the new Prime Minister was Margaret Thatcher.
The whole economic circumstances changed completely. We in the business are tending to look for pretty early returns on our money.
The brakes were binding, causing serious overheating. The new transfer gearboxes had lubrication problems, which have not yet been finally resolved. Bolts on the axles had a tendency to work loose, BR admitted to one derailment. And the very basis of APT technology, the tilt, had a design problem.
In 1985, the British Rail Board finally lost patience and pulled the plug on the tilting train.
British Rail won't be building any more advanced passenger trains like this one. These test runs are now research for the next generation of high-speed trains due in the 1990s.
They never really had the chance to prove that they could do it and develop this marvellous tilting train.
The multi-million pound project was deemed suitable only for scrap. And so the trains were unceremoniously torn to shreds.
What happened was it was like, get rid of it. And we never want to see it again.
For the father of the APT, it's a far cry from the original vision.
I'd call it an emasculated advanced passenger train.
The train was taken out of service and became an attraction at a heritage centre in Crewe.
Like the experimental train, the prototype APT now sits rotting away in a museum. Occasionally, it's used for children's parties.
APT was an idea, and it was the right idea, but it didn't quite work.
Italian tilting trains from Fiat, developed using much of the technology that Wickens and Newman had created. It is a cruel and bitter irony.
It wasn't a particularly brave decision to make. I mean, it was perhaps a slightly brave decision to bring it back to a country where it had failed so dramatically. But it certainly was the right decision.